Good evening. Welcome to the Berean Baptist Church and a Wednesday prayer meeting night. Good to see you all. As you well know, our pastor is on vacation, so we're just filling in, doing the best we can. And it's glad to have some visitors. Andreessen family is here, and you folks were here last Sunday night. I was not, and so I guess you're coming back. That's good. Appreciate that. And we're down tonight a little bit, but hey, we're up in spirit, right? Thank you. All right, let's take our hymn books. Turn to number 421, My Sins Are Gone. Let's all stand together on this one. Remain standing for prayer. And we'll get through this night. 421. On the first. You ask me why I'm happy, so I'll just tell you why. Because my sins are gone. And with scoffers who ask me where they are, I say my sins are gone. They're underneath the blood on the cross of Calvary, as far removed as darkness is from dawn. Sea of God's forgetfulness, it's good enough for me. Praise God, my sins are gone. 'Twas at the old time altar when God came in my heart, and now my sins are gone. The Lord took full possession, the devil did his part. I'm glad my sins are gone. They're underneath the blood on the cross of Calvary, as far removed as darkness is from dawn. The sea of God's forgetfulness, that's good enough for me. Praise God, my sins are gone. When Satan comes to tempt me and tries to make me doubt, I say, my sins are gone. You got me into trouble, got me out. My sins are gone. They're underneath the blood of the cross of Calvary, as far removed as darkness is from dawn. Sea of God's forgetfulness, that's good enough for me. Praise God, my sins are gone. I'm living now for Jesus, and I'm happy today because my sins are gone. My soul is filled with music, with all my heart I say, I know my sins are gone. Underneath the blood on the cross of Calvary, as far removed as darkness is from dawn. In the sea of God's forgetfulness, that's good enough for me. Praise God, my sins are gone. Amen, amen. All right, let's begin with prayer. And then we'll continue on. Father, we thank you that we can gather in your house tonight. Thank you for the freedom that we enjoy, that we can do this. And we just look forward tonight, Lord, just praising you in song and hearing the precious word of God preached tonight. We also, Lord, want to thank you for the privilege of prayer that will follow after this service. God, we can lift these requests, many, many requests, unto you. That God, you will hear, you will answer, and we thank you for that. Now, Lord, bless each one that's here tonight, Lord, and those who are gone away from us, Lord, just be with them. And Lord, we just want to thank you. We do praise you in your precious, wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. All right, you may be seated as we turn to 496 channels only. 496. Four ready. How I praise thee, precious Savior, that thy love laid hold of me. Thou hast saved and cleansed and filled me, that I might thy channel be. Channels only, blessed Master, but with all thy wondrous power. Flowing through us, thou canst use us every day and every hour. Thou shouldest fill me, a clean vessel in thy hand, with no power but thou givest graciously with each command. Most only, blessed Master, but with all thy wondrous power, flowing through us, thou canst use up every day and every hour. Witnessing thy power to save me, setting free from self and sin, thou broughtest to possess me. In thy fullness, Lord, come in. Chains only, blessed Master, but with all thy wondrous power, flowing through us, thou canst use us every day and every hour. Jesus, fill now with thy Spirit hearts that full surrender know, that the streams of living water from our inner man may flow. Channels only, blessed Master, but with all thy wondrous power, flowing through us, thou can use us every day and every. Amen. All right.
Good singing
tonight. Announcements. If you're involved in the FBI class, that will be online tomorrow. And I believe next week. Maybe. All depends if the director is here. Anyway, don't forget Saturday is 8:30 men's prayer meeting. I believe Mick Reagan is going to be holding that meeting, and we thank him for that. Sunday morning, Brother John Martin from Somerville will be down. He'll be preaching both the Sunday school and the morning message, and so be here for that. We love John. He's pretty good, very good man. Also, if you like the Dwell devotional, we have some copies on the back turnstile back there for those who use Dwell. And it's a pretty good magazine, I guess, according to Sharon. So that's good. You like that, Haley? You like these? Yeah? Okay, pick one up later. All right. Last night, as you know, Hope with Options here in town, the Pregnancy Crisis Center, had their big dinner, donation dinner, and many of us attended. And it was a good time. Very, very good. Very good. The meal was good. And Brother Ben Carson, he was good when he spoke, and spoke out of his heart about saving lives. And gave us some encouragement, challenged us that we're here for such a time as this. And it was good. It was very good. A lot of people, 520 or so, they scheduled in there, and they wanted to raise $225,000 to not only pay for that event, which was expensive, but more money for salaries and for help, and just to take care of women who need to come in and talk to people and get those, what is it, sonograms or ultrasounds, yeah. So that's all expensive, and they just want to help gals keep their babies, keep life. And so we thank him for being there, and it was a great time. Other than that, of course, pastor's on vacation, and tomorrow will be a full week. He'll be back next Thursday, Lord willing. He's on his way to Kentucky to see the Ark. The Ark. Right, Glenn, you've been there. So he's looking forward to seeing that, and then he's heading down to Tennessee to see some relatives of Debbie's, and then go to Crown College. Find Andrew Goodman, and maybe talk to Brother Sexton. I don't know. So we're going to have to hold the fort till that time. Anyway, there's Mary Lee. Saw your parents last night at the dinner. No, I did, really. They were there. A lot of people were there. Okay, no other announcements. Anybody have anything? I just want to update you on the Nita Werfers. Good news, bad news. Mark and Anna made it just fine. Carl and Sue are in Walla Walla. Apparently something wrong with the plane, and they didn't have any other planes to take them to Seattle. They missed the flight from Seattle to Hawaii, so we need to pray tonight for them that they can make it before the wedding on Friday. I'm sure they're just really upset about that. That's terrible. So we will do that in a little while. Take your hymn books one more time, 184. Day by day. Let's all stand one more time before the preaching. All standing if you can. Ready? Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He's who heart is kind beyond all measure, gives unto each day what he deems best. Lovingly, it's part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest. Every day, the Lord himself is near me with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares he fain would bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor and Power, the protection of his and treasure, is a charge that on himself is laid. The days thy strength shall be measured, this the pledge to me he made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith's sweet consolation offered me within thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil, trouble, meaning, e'er to take as from a father's hand. Days of moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land. They can be seated, or you want them standing? It don't matter. All right, he may be seated. Our special speaker tonight, none other than Brother Craig Andreessen. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, sir. All right. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Yeah, so Jim gave me a hard time about bringing my own cheering section or amen section tonight, so. Hey, you know, whatever. It is what it is, so. All right, and for those watching us online, yes, Pastor's not here, so I'm just going to apologize to you up front, but no, I'm kidding. And for those of you that went to go see Ben Carson last night, I am not Ben Carson, so. I just want to make sure we're all where the bar is at. So anyways, all right. Well, hey, it's still going to be a good night. So, you know, regardless, God's in, you know, we're here and we're gathered together. So praise the Lord for that. All right. And so so tonight we're actually, I'm going to be talking about fear, but specifically fear of death, which I thought was, you know, God laid it on my heart, and, you know, then, anyhow. All right, so if you want to, you can go ahead and stay seated, but we're going to start out tonight in 2 Corinthians. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and so we'll start in verse 1. And what's interesting is if you happen to have a Scofield Bible, by chance, the little notes underneath the chapter says, why death itself has no terrors for the servant of the Lord. So I thought that was kind of interesting when I got into this. But so 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we'll start in verse 1, says, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, an house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is from heaven. If so be, that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for what we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. And then verse 8, we are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Let's pray. Father, Lord, I do thank you tonight for just allowing us to be here, Lord, allowing us to be able to worship you openly. Lord, I do pray tonight that you would, let your word speak and not my own here tonight, Lord. And we just thank you for this time. We thank you for your word and do ask for your blessing tonight and pray in Jesus' name, amen. So one time, this was several years ago, I read a booklet that came from a hospice center. And in this booklet, it talked about those that are dying. And, you know, this is more for the family, you know, what to expect when someone is dying. And it talked about, you know, whether they have that fear of death or whether they're embracing it. And, you know, they could say that they could often tell if the patient was afraid or not. You know, and generally what they said, if they were afraid, they would be fighting. They would be wanting to stay alive. They would not want to be dying. And then those that were embracing it were surprisingly peaceful as they were entering into death. So tonight my message, it's got 3 points, but like I'm sure Pastor would appreciate, there are a few subpoints, but I'll be brief about them. My 3 points are: why would we be afraid? Why would we have peace? And then how can we have that peace? So I know a few times in my life, I've had the fear of death. One time when I was a teenager, and I'm not going to go into the full details of this story while we're online and being recorded for posterity, so I'll kind of be a little generalized, and then we can talk later. But let's just say it was about this time of year. I was 14 years old, so for those of you that know what's going on this time of year, Ms. Sharon, okay? So I'm in my living room, and something happens, and unfortunately, I had to call my mom and dad and tell them what happened. And then I had to wait. And that whole time, I thought I was going to die. I knew, not so much when mom got home, but I knew when dad got home, I was going to die. That was the last breaths that I was going to be taking. Praise the Lord, I didn't. And there were some consequences, and unfortunately some long-term you know memories that I will always have to live with what happened. But and that's about as much detail as you're going to get right now. Okay. But my folks are here, so you can feel free. They will corroborate anything. I see my dad smiling, so he knows what I'm talking about. And then as I got a little bit older, as a young adult, I was 18 years old. It was a Friday afternoon. I just started college, and I was riding my motorcycle, having a good time. And the next thing I knew, I was in some dreamlike state, Superman off the back of my motorcycle. Yeah, as I was crashing it into the trees around the corner from my house. Again, I did not have to make the phone call that time. Someone else made that phone call for me because I just kept repeating my name, address, and phone number over and over again. Thankfully, and this was before cell phones were, you know, a big thing, and you know, thankfully someone had a cell phone. They called 911. And then also called home. Again, my folks were there, and you know, had to come and show up, and you know, thinking, okay, Craig just put his bicycle, you know, his motorcycle down. We'll go pick it up, and you know, they show up, and there's three cop cars, ambulance, two fire trucks. You know, it's like the cavalry showed up out there, and then it's a good thing that at that point in time, I don't really have a lot of conscious memory, because apparently the bushes I was in, I was covered in spiders. And for those of you that know me, I don't do spiders. So I probably would have gone into cardiac arrest had I been conscious enough to know what was going on there. But anyways, thankfully, God got me through that one as well. And then as an older adult, it was a Thanksgiving time, and for those of you that know me, I can be a little bit on the ornery side. I know, gasp, shock. So it's Thanksgiving time, and well, needless to say, due to my orneriness, I ended up tossing a little bit of water at my mother while we were at Thanksgiving dinner with the whole family at the house. And at that moment, after I realized what I had done, I thought I was going to die as my mother started chasing me around the house. I knew I was in the clear until went through a doorway and was gone, and she just held her hand up to hold the door, and I had so much momentum that into the door I went. And then I come walking down the stairs, blood running down my face from where my glasses smashed into it, and there was a lot of silence from the other guests wondering what had happened. So a few times anyways. And I jokingly say I thought I was gonna die that one I really did. But so anyways. So why would we be afraid? Well, generally we are afraid of, you know, one of two things. We're either afraid of the unknown. Hey, what's gonna happen? What are we doing? Where am I at? Or we're afraid of the known. We actually know what's at the end of the path. We know where we're going. We know where we're at. So we're not usually somewhere in between. We either fear of the unknown or we're fear of the known. I'm afraid of spiders. I get it. I know them. I see them. I'm also sometimes afraid of the unknown. I have to give Caleb credit for, you know, working up on the roof of the church here. Could I have done it? I mean, with a harness tight to the edge, I'm good. But that unknowing of how sturdy my feet are going to be or how I'm going to do, I'm not so good about that. So, but as we get into this and thinking about that booklet, you know, the fear of the unknown, So why would we have that fear? Well, one is, where am I going? You know, when I die, where am I going? And, you know, why would we not know? And I think about, you know, folks that have either never been presented with the gospel, so they don't know. They don't know because they have not heard, you know, and like the Bible says, how can they hear without a preacher? But they've never heard. The other is confusion. You know, confusion from other sources, whether that be cults, like we're learning about in our Sunday school, adult Sunday school lessons, other religions out there, science. You know, if you look at science, it has a lot of ideas of what may or may not happen when we die. Just ask them. And then, you know, look at the media. They get a plethora of things that they will gladly throw out there for money and just about tell you whatever you want to hear to make you feel better or make you feel worse so that they can sell more ads. You know, another thing of the unknown is, you know, what's going to happen? So not only where am I going, but what's going to happen? Yeah, am I going to be reincarnated as a cow? I really hope not, because I like to eat them. I would not want to be one. Hey, yeah, that would be, or as a spider, you know, because of how we acted. Maybe we don't get to move up, we move down and become other animals or fungus or any number of things. Or you think about those that, like we learned this last week, you know, that where they teach that you have no soul and you'll just be annihilated. Essentially, once your life is over, you're done. You know, you cease to exist. Well, then that brings us into the known. So we kind of look at some things of what would be unknown. So what would be known? Well, we know, maybe it's because we've been told, maybe it's just because we know that we're sinners destined for hell. You know, Romans 3:10 says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. So not a one of us in here. And then just a few verses later in Romans 3:23, you know, it says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So every one of us, every one of us. And that includes those that have not heard. Those that have not heard the gospel are still all. That's everyone. And then back in Psalm 9:17, it says, the wicked shall be turned into hell and the nations that forget God. So even before we had, you know, the book of Romans in the New Testament and Paul giving us that, you know, back in the book of Psalms. So in the Old Testament, and still, we knew, you know, this is where we're going as a sinner. You know, we're the wicked shall be, you know, sent to hell. We're sinners. We're wicked to begin with. You know, something else that I have seen, and unfortunately, it hurts me when I've seen coworkers and talked to coworkers that. You know, they're sold this bill of goods that hell's going to be a party. You know, it's like, hey, we're just, you know, hey, me and all my friends, we're going to be down there and we're just going to party and live it up. And so they think it's just going to be maybe a little bit warmer, like, you know, Arizona in the summertime. And then that's, you know, that's where it's going to be. Or sometimes Pendleton in the summertime, the past couple of years, it's been really warm. Or we think we have all the time in the world. You know, we get told that. You know, live it up. You've got years ahead of you. You know, James says our lives are like a vapor. You know, it appears for a little time and then vanishes away. So it's just a vapor. You know, and you think about it. I was talking with Nathan earlier tonight about. You know, it seems like how time is moving so much faster as you get older. And well, yeah, when you're little, you know, a year is like a fourth of your life, an eighth of your life, a tenth of your life. That's a big portion of it. But then it gets into a 40th of your life, or a 60th, or a 70th, or an 80th of your life. And that year is just a really small part of your time. And then you really get to see how fast that vapor is. And even as we think about it, you know, if we think about how, you know, the age of our earth, you know, not the millions of years, but the 6,000-ish years, still 40, 60, 80 years of that is but a small portion. It's still like a vapor, you know, even if we looked at it outside of, you know, the biblical scripture of what we're told. And then Jesus, you know, he called that man a fool that tore down his barns to build bigger ones, you know, to eat, drink, and be merry. You know, thou fool. I mean, tonight your soul shall be required of you. We think we have all the time in the world. It's, you know, I know I've heard countless preachers that have told stories of folks that have, you know, that they've been witnessing to, and it's like, okay, have it in their calendar. I'm going to be to church. I'm going to do this on Sunday, and they never make it to Sunday because they don't take that opportunity when it's given to them. So those are all things that why we would be afraid. We don't know where we're going, or we do know where we're going because we've been told. But we think we have time, or we've been told that it's going to be a party, or you know, well, we're going to turn into a cow or something crazy like that. Well, why would we have peace? Well, pretty simple. I remember as a kid, you know, you had to learn the who, what, where, when, why, how, all of that. Well, I'm going to talk a little bit about who, what, how. So John 1:29 says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Well, that's who. And then Jesus tells us down in later on in John 14:6 that Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So John the Baptist said, that's the Lamb of the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. And Jesus himself says, I am that way, the truth, and the life. And then with that, let's turn over to 1 John, and this one's a little bit longer. 1 John chapter 5, in verse 11, it says, and this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. So that's the who. Why should we have peace? Who? Well, it's Christ Jesus. He's our sacrifice. He was the sacrifice to take away our sins. But we have to know him. It's not just to know about him. We have to know him. So we know. Okay, this is now we can have peace because we know who we're going to see at that time when we die. But then where are we going? Well, back in John chapter 14, in verses 2 and 3, it says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, ye may be also. So, Jesus told us who he was, and where he's going, and in his house, in his father's house are many mansions. That's where we're going if we have that peace. And then in Luke chapter 23, starting in verse 39, this is as Jesus is up on the cross. One of the malefactors, which were hanged, railed on him, saying, "If thou be Christ, save thyself and us." But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Dost thou not fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly." So he knew why he was up there. Like, we're here because we deserve it. Just like every one of us. We're guilty because we deserve it. "For we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." So, Jesus, he tells us there's a place prepared for us. And then he says, today you'll be with me. So, that thief on the cross, he was absent from the body and present with the Lord. Just like we read back in 2 Corinthians, to be absent from the body, present with the Lord. And then what is it that we get, you know, from that peace? And what is it that we can expect, you know, once we're there? Well, we shall be just like that thief on the cross. You know, verily, verily, I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. You know Christ is your Savior. On that day, thou shalt be with him in paradise. And then he kind of tells us about it and what it'll be like longer term. You know, not just the here and now. And that's, so before I got saved, I love the song Amazing Grace. It's it's a song I've heard for a long time. I would hear it at funerals. I would hear it, oftentimes at bagpipes at a firefighter funeral. It would give me goosebumps, and I would think about that. But I never really understood the words, especially the last verse. When we've been there 10,000 years, but it'd be like we've just been there, because we still have eternity ahead of us. Even if we've been there 10,000 years, we still have eternity ahead of us. And it never dawned on me until I got saved, and then it clicked. It's like, oh, that's what it means. You know, we're going to be there, and it'll be just like the same day. We still have another 10,000 years, and another 10,000 years after that. That we get to spend with him. And then if we turn to Revelation chapter 21, starting in verse 1, you know, this is John speaking. He says, "I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain." Amen. Yeah. Yeah. "For the former things are passed away." And he that sat upon the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said unto me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." And he said unto me, "It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. That's the what. That's what we get to look forward to. We get to look forward to being a son of God, or daughter, right? But we get to be one of his children, and we get to be one of his children for eternity, with no pain, with no sorrow. All things become new, and that's pretty special. So I have to do my Pastor Watkins, Marco Rubio. Apologize. I kind of hope he watches this just to... Not Marco Rubio. I know Marco Rubio is not going to watch our video, but I hope Pastor watches. Nah. If I'm not careful, he might be watching now, and I'm going to get a phone call here in about 20 minutes. Hey. Or Jim's going to get a phone call. Don't let Craig up there ever again. All right. So... We talked about what? Well, how can you have that peace? How can you go from that fear of death, from being afraid, to having that peace? Well, first we have to recognize that we are sinners. You know, I mean, God told us we're sinners. But just because God told us we're sinners doesn't mean that we necessarily recognize that. We have to recognize that we're a sinner. I mean, I know that there are lots of things that I've been told that I can hear, but until I understand and I recognize that myself, it kind of goes in one ear and out the other. Anyways, and so Romans 5:12, you know, sin came from Adam and passed to all of us. And then we read in chapter 6 and verse 23 that, you know, the wages of sin is death. So that's what we have to, you know, we're going to die because of our wages. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. And with that, we had to recognize that Christ died for our sins. You know, Romans 5, 8, and 9 says, "But God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." Not of us, not of our works, saved through him. You know, thinking about some of those cults that we're learning about, and some of the other religions, and how they talk about how There's things that you have to do. You know, you have to do something to earn your salvation, to do. Well, the Bible tells us the only thing we've earned is death. Those are our wages. It doesn't say anything in there about, hey, work just a little bit harder, and then, you know, you can tip those scales, and then you can have that life instead of death. No, those are our wages. That's what we all are earning, every single one of us. And because of that, there's nothing that we can do. Getting baptized is not going to save you. It's not going to keep you saved. Doing good works, tithing, any of these things, doing, you know, the Lord's Supper or communion, or, you know, saying a Hail Mary 47 times, or, you know, any of those things, they're not going to save you. They're not going to keep you saved. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. It's that simple. Saved by wrath through him. But then we have to accept that free gift as well. Romans chapter 10. And these are all, you know, common verses that many of us have read through many times. In verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever, that's all of us, that any of us can, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So we have to accept that free gift. We can know where we're going. We can know we're a sinner. We can know that Christ died for us. But we have to accept it. We have to make that. That's what we have to do. We have to accept that gift. You know, thinking about Abigail with the baby showers. You get all these free gifts. Some of them you don't want. Some of them you it's like, hey, I can re-gift this to someone else. But those are free gifts. But you have to accept it. You have to take it. If you leave the gift behind, you didn't accept that gift. So Christ is giving us the gift. We have to accept it. We have to take it. And so I know we've got a little bit of time. I just want to give a little bit of my testimony for those of you that don't know, and which is maybe several of you. But when I was 14 years old, I prayed a prayer and got wet. I got baptized. And was told, hey, done, you did it, good job, that's kind of it. But I never really felt anything, and I'd hear people talk about how, when you know, and I didn't really know. But I thought I knew, because I had said a few words, and I got wet, so that had to been right. And it had been nagging on me for a long time. And when I was 28 years old, I'd been the youth leader at our church in Klamath Falls for almost 2 years by that point. It was actually the second time I had taken kids to camp. And there were lots of things that happened at that camp that we can talk about those later. They were funny, but we'll talk about that later. What not to do to your camp counselor. But anyways, one thing that did happen is there was a preacher there that gave his testimony. And he talked about how he was younger, and then he was an assistant pastor, and had this just nagging feeling. And didn't know what everybody else was talking about. And he, would come home from work, and it was quiet in the house. And he had four kids, and they were homeschooled, and so it would be quiet at the house. And he'd go, okay, well, did the rapture happen? And I not know about it. Okay, and then he'd, hear something, or the phone would ring, it would be his wife, and so he, all right, made it through another day. I'm sitting in there, same thing, like, were you, like, reading my mind as you're talking here? Because I'd done the same thing. I come home, and it was quiet. I only had one kid at home at the time, and he was, he was little. Not quite a year old. Yeah. But I'd come home and it was quiet. And I'd wonder, okay, did I miss the rapture? And so what's that going to be like when I'm sitting there and, like, I watch my wife leave me? That's going to be really awkward and really disappointing. And then he kept going and he talked about how he'd fought it for so long because he was embarrassed. Because he was an adult. and he was in a position of authority in the church. And what's everybody gonna say? And unfortunately, I had a lot of that. Well, what's everybody gonna say? And so I'm sitting there like, yeah, okay, yeah, yeah. I mean, and my heart is just pounding. Like, I'm freaking out as he's, sitting here giving his testimony. And so then he says, at that point, it's just like he couldn't do it anymore. He had to get saved and then had to figure out, okay, God, you got to help me tell people because I can't do this otherwise. And so he got saved and then it wasn't a bad thing. Like, his pastor embraced him and was thrilled. My pastor at the time was kind of I was afraid of him. So I didn't want to tell him anything. So I'm sitting there thinking the same thing. I was like, okay, I got to. So I went out, and as soon as that service was over, me and God had some time together. And it was at that moment, July 22nd of 2009, like, I knew at that point. And there was no question. And I still had to tell people. I told the camp director, and he gave me the biggest bear hug that I think I've ever had from a grown man before. But it was pretty awesome. Unfortunately, there were some other people. It was really disappointing that didn't, when it was kind of announced that they had, another was saved and it was an adult, there were some other counselors with another church that made some snide remarks. They didn't know who it was. I happened to just be standing right next to him and made some snide remarks. And I was like, wow, you know what? I don't care. But that was kind of rude. And that's why I purpose in my heart. I'm like, you know what? If there's an adult that gets saved, and I am not going to be that person to judge them. Amen. And then I had to go home and I had to tell my pastor, and he gave me the biggest bear hug, and it was probably the best moment that him and I had ever had. And then he retired and moved away a month later. So we kind of went out on a good note. It was good. But I also had to tell those teenagers. We had 19 teenagers that we took to camp that year, and I had to tell every one of them that I was a fraud. That's what I'm thinking in my head. Like, I'm a fraud. I'm teaching Sunday school classes, and I'm just reading words out of a book that don't mean anything. And you know what? Those teenagers, which can be a tough crowd, they loved on me too. And there were three of our teenagers I thought were saved, said, we need to go forward and get saved. Well, and then, then my heart's beating again. I'm like, that's awesome. This is so cool. And I know I'm still a sinner, but I know now when it's quiet at home, I don't have that fear of, oh, I missed the rapture. It's quiet. This is awesome. I'm going to take just a little bit and enjoy this. And then also try to provide that to my wife every now and then too, because I know she doesn't always have quiet times. Unfortunately, I have three boys and she has four. So, last verse, Philippians 4:7 says, "And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." So we can have that peace that hospice department was writing about, was telling us about, that they didn't really understand, but they had observed, and so we're just putting that down to help folks try to understand. We don't always understand, But we have that peace, and that peace comes through Christ Jesus. So let's pray. Father, Lord, I thank you for this night tonight. Lord, I thank you just for this this opportunity to come up here, Lord. And Father, I would just pray that tonight, if anyone doesn't know you as their Savior, Lord, that that tonight would be the night of their salvation, Lord, that they would come to know you and would accept you. They would accept that free gift that you have given to us and provided, Lord, if we just take it. And so again, Lord, I just thank you and praise you tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me collect my stuff. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Craig. Thanks, Craig. Appreciate that message. Would you might be interested in preaching Sunday night? No? Yes? Did so well. I got money. All right, let's take our hymn book and let's close with number 241, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. Let's all stand together. Good message. Thank you for that. And Pastor, if you've been listening, if you're out there listening in Indiana or Kentucky, take 2 or 3 more weeks if you want. We're doing just great. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Let's go down to verse number 4. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all.